Let's make the future.
That is the whole idea of this machine, you know. Deterrence is the art of producing in the mind of the enemy the fear to attack. And so, because of the automated and irrevocable decision-making process which rules out human meddling, the doomsday machine is terrifying. It's simple to understand and completely credible and convincing.
Gee, I wish we had one of them doomsday machines, Stacy.
Welcome to Let's Make the Future, a discussion about future trends, technologies, and their implications for human society. We are coming to you from all over the world, featuring the voices of Michael Curry, Hossein Kouhani, Daniel Valenzuela, Michael Oloraniwo, and Parnion Barakatane. Music and editing, Christian Peltonen. This episode's discussion topic, military technology, with Boaz Faraday Schumann. Brought to you by Fling.Asia, urban drone delivery. Get it fast. Fling it. Fling.
So, Boaz, thank you so much for coming today and for participating.
You're
welcome. And thank you, everyone else, as well. Today's topic is future military technologies. I look forward to an hour of discussing some interesting technologies and their implications for military strategy, military outcomes, and for the world. So I'm Michael Curry. I am a software developer and entrepreneur, and I've been based out of Southeast Asia for the last couple of years, but I'm currently on business in my home country of Canada.
Hi, this is Hossein, abbreviated as Hoss. I am a PhD student at Michigan State University making biomedical sensors, and hopefully one day get more advanced to be called like cyborg technologies.
I'm Daniel Valenzuela. I'm currently based in Munich. I'm a mathematician and social impact enthusiast, and I work currently on industrial Internet of Things and how that relates to work and labor in Germany.
My name is Michael Oloraniwo, and I'm based in Palo Alto, in California. I recently concluded my master's at Stanford University and currently working as a chief entrepreneur on blockchain innovation.
Boaz, you're our last but not least here. Go ahead.
Well, in fact, in some respects, I think I am least on such a star-studded panel. My name is Boaz Schumann. I'm a PhD student. I work on the history of logic, mostly 14th century and kind of correspondences with the 20th. But I take a great interest in strategy and specifically in air power. And that's, I think, why Michael has invited me here. So nice to meet you all. And thanks for doing this, Michael.
Great. Thank you all for participating. So it seems like the history of military technology stretching back thousands of years has been one of innovation leading to changed military outcomes. So from the English long bow changing the course of the wars between England and France to nuclear warfare, or the threat of nuclear warfare, changing the power dynamics and the possibility of warfare between America and the Soviet Union, we've seen how technology is the decisive factor in warfare, not necessarily a size of an economy or the power of a politician's rhetoric, etc. Technology seems to be by far the decisive factor in most conflicts. That's, I guess, my contention right now. And so what I'd be interested in discussing is maybe first that concept. Do we think that that's true? And then second, we could just go over a kind of a laundry list of potential future technologies and how we think that might change the power balance of the world. Because I think it's through the lens of technology that we will be able to get a powerful insight into the state of the future politics in the world in a way that might lead us to be more prescient than other people and the average person in the world today.
Can I jump right on that, Michael, and just add something? You had said that technology was more important than, say, political rhetoric, and you went through a sort of litany of things, and I agree with that. I would add to that, though, one that you left out, which is population size. This is something that interests me a great deal because as some of these technologies, especially unmanned, as they call them, more automated technologies, become more and more widely available, that might also itself even out. Lockheed Martin, for instance, is making this, what is it, the littoral combat ship. Littoral as in shoreline, not literal, that takes something like 10% of the usual crew required to run it, if memory serves. And that's a great leap because then you can deploy more. But of course, if the technology becomes widely available and people just have a larger population, that advantage is going to start evening out.
That's a great point. Does anyone else have any opening thoughts about this? Because population, yeah, is, I guess, not as much of a factor as it might once have been. All right. So maybe it's worth thinking about the history of military engagements. Can anyone reach into their memory and think about their understanding of past conflicts and how technology might have been a decisive factor in a particular engagement?
I don't want to keep, you know, taking the bait every time, but yeah, okay. So you mentioned the English longbow, which was adopted from the Welsh, was used with considerable success, I think, against the Scottish, and they said, okay, we'll turn this for use against the French, which had the advantage of, well, it had range, considerable range, so it was able to compete with crossbows in terms of range, but it was also able to be reloaded much more quickly than a crossbow. And so basically the engagement was possible at a much greater distance than the French were capable of keeping up with. And I think this was decisive in some naval battles in the Hundred Years' War. And fast forward to the 20th century, you mentioned nuclear warfare. And in a certain sense, there's something of a similarity between the two, at least in as much as you're able to strike your enemies sort of without them even being able to get together retaliation. But I would walk back a bit of the optimism about nuclear armaments for at least one reason. A lot of the rhetoric about mutually assured destruction that we see now is very similar in sort to the kind that came out at the very beginning of the 20th century when air power became a thing. So there are all these very optimistic and very enthusiastic theorists of air power who wrote, this will be the end of war because we'll be able to just fly over them and devastate their cities, devastate their industry and so forth. War will become impossible, materially impossible. Of course, we saw a lot of devastation in World War II, but we didn't see people treating it as though it was impossible. It just was a level of devastation we hadn't seen before.
But Boaz, can I interrupt you there? Because I think the key to preventing warfare through mutually assured destruction, I believe the military theory on this is that if it is impossible to destroy the enemy's counterforce capability, that is, their ability to strike back after a first strike, if you can't be assured of getting every single military installation in the first strike, then it is a very stable military situation because neither side has the incentive to strike first. Whereas if there is the possibility that you could destroy their entire counterforce capability and that you could just, as you say, lay waste to their defenses in one fell swoop, then there is a strong incentive to strike first and then warfare becomes extremely likely. So I would argue that what were you saying at the beginning then with the air power, was this already where they're saying the bomber will always get through and then, you know, you can't really stop the counterforce and therefore war would stop? Or were you basically saying instead they're just going to destroy the enemy and then America will reign supreme or something?
No, actually, these were a lot of not Americans writing on this at all. I think it was Italian and English theorists. I'm not sure whether they actually use the word bomber. I have to go back and look that up. But I guess what I'm saying is that sometimes it seems like it's what you say. It's like, okay, it'll be so destructive, it'll eliminate any counterstrike possibilities. But on the other hand, sometimes it just seems like the statement on nuclear power is similar to what air power was. It will be so devastating that no one would ever do it. And that, to me, is a bit of a worry. I understand that the conventional thinking on this is that such mutually assured destruction prevents anything like that. But even the risk of accidents, of course, has shown that to be a bit sanguine. Is that the word I want? In any case, my point merely is that I'm not sure whether we're talking about a qualitatively different kind of destruction or whether we're just talking about a quantitative leap that we think no one would make, because that's something that's been said before and it didn't work out.
All right.
So I wanted to jump in there. I wonder what you think about what technology will play in the effectiveness of warfare campaigns. Like over the course of history, we've had a situation whereby prediction regarding the length or the cost of warfare is being very underestimated. And given technology, you have the human toll on the humanitarian toll from warfare. You have the cost of military life, and then you also have the cost of logistics and all of that. And I wonder if we have looking to the future, that there's going to be some advancement in terms of saying, okay, how effectively are you able to deploy? Do you know how much this would cost you? And if you're able to do that, how would that, you know, determine political willpower to go and launch a combat campaign?
Mm-hmm. Michael, can you just clarify? So what you're saying is the implications of being able to deploy, I think I might have missed what you were saying in terms of deploying. What were you saying there?
I was saying that what role will technology play in the future in terms of helping us to determine the actual cost of a planning campaign and also minimizing both the humanitarian toll, because what's been happening over time and why most governments are not less willing to go to war is because you really cannot estimate how much a planning campaign will, military campaign will cost you and how long it will take. And over time, we've always underestimated the capacity of the enemy and from historical warfare in the past.
Yeah, it seems to me like the surveillance or intelligence, technology that gives you information about the enemy's capabilities and therefore might lead to like a better understanding of how long a campaign might take place. With respect to that kind of technology, having watched the movie about Alan Turing, during World War II, and then just reading about Bletchley Park and their work there, it seems like, although of course this wasn't discussed in the years following World War II, the fact that the British had insight into Nazi troop movements and, sorry, I guess naval positions, and that they never revealed the fact that they knew this to the Nazis was a decisive advantage in being able to position their ships properly and avoid attacks. And so it does seem like having an informational advantage over your enemy is a very, very powerful technology. So in a way, the geeks at Bletchley Park were able to win the war in a sense that the soldiers were not able to achieve in the form of a decisive advantage.
Well, I mean, you wouldn't have one without the other. Yeah. I wouldn't downplay the role that the soldiers played as well. Bletchley Park would have been very easily overrun in spite of their situational awareness if they hadn't had a hard exterior protecting them. But your point is well taken.
Fair enough, yeah. It's a good point. And it does seem like in the future, we're going to have, of course, there's more and more information that's being generated by society, the internet, etc. And our society is more and more dependent on information technology to give us food, to give us everything that we do on a daily basis, our power infrastructure, our, you know, everything. When it's all dependent on a very, very complicated information infrastructure, that means that we're vulnerable to a cyber attack in a way that we perhaps weren't in the past. So I'm not sure how that affects military dynamics, but yeah, certainly there.
Can I follow up with that and also add that the way that the information is shared seems to be, and this is not my, by the way, there are people who can speak on this here in this panel much more authoritatively than I can, but I'm interested in also in the way that information is so much more diffuse now thanks to the internet. So I was really impressed to see the way that Twitter was used by some of these militant groups in the Middle East who were live tweeting battles and things and directing and coordinating their efforts in that way. So I guess if you just hashtag, you pick whatever your hashtag is for the battle for this or that town that's going on, and then you can coordinate amongst yourselves who's going where and who is where and so forth. I feel like I was taught a great deal of the extent of Twitter. I think we all learned a great deal about how much more Twitter can be used for than I ever would have appreciated before. My point is, it's not just state actors that are able to do this. It's also very loosely allied or, I don't know what the technical term is, insurgents,
right.
I guess.
Yeah.
Not professional militaries.
Well, let me ask the rest of the panel here what they think. Actually, before we do that, let's just say hello to Parnian, who's joined us. Hello, Parni.
Hi, Parni.
Hello.
Hello. Nice to talk to you.
Hi.
So we have a guest today, Parni. We have Boaz Faraday Schumann, who is a philosophy PhD student, and we're talking about military technologies. And Boaz has just raised the point that some of these technologies, specifically information technologies like Twitter, are making it possible for even the general population, or for non-state actors at least, to...
Yeah, so that's the term, yeah.
Yeah. To coordinate their activities. Non-state actors? Okay, yeah, fair enough. And so what I think maybe that leads us into is a question about whether we think future technology is going to lead to a consolidation of the power of the state, or whether it will lead to the undermining of the power of the state. Because we can see various technologies leading one way or the other. And so maybe people have some thoughts about that.
So you're asking, just to understand your question, if the military technologies would undermine the power of states? Was that your question?
Exactly.
Can you elaborate what you mean by that? Are you mentioning the terrorist groups, or?
It could be terrorist groups that are undermining the power of the state, but it could also also be the state becomes less relevant in our lives because we're able to defend ourselves, you know, just regular people are able to defend themselves and protect their interests without the involvement of the state. For example, cryptography might make it possible for end-to-end communication without snooping by the NSA. You could also have other technologies that make it possible to, I suppose, like 3D printed guns, that sort of technology that makes it possible to always be able to defend yourself even if the state doesn't want you to. On the other hand, artificial intelligence and automated robotic soldiers might make it possible for even a dictator with the support of no one in the entire country. Imagine Bashar al-Assad with a million robot soldiers. Even if the entire country is turned against him and there's no person in the country that wants him to be president, he can stay president with those infinitely loyal soldiers. So what technology reigns supreme? What will win over? Will it be the technologies that help people or be the technologies that help states?
Can I just pick up on this, Michael? I don't want to, you know,
go
say
right
too
ahead.
Much. Okay, so I think this is an interesting question. And I think it kind of is going to have to be both. And I'm not going to come down on one side or another. But I will say that at least one way in which state power will be, I think, undermined somewhat is in what I'm calling, you could almost call the democratization of warfare or something, that it's becoming more diffuse. So for those of us who watched the battle for Mosul very well, as closely as I could with my other commitment, it's very interesting to see the use of unmanned aerial vehicles on pretty much all sides in the conflict. And so here's a case in which a technology that was adopted very quickly by the United States allowed them to attack aircraft that could be shot down without loss of troops, which is always such a huge disaster. That gave a slight edge. But then, as I say, you know, over time, other groups started adopting some of those approaches. Admittedly, their tactics are very different as far as I've seen. But the U.S. doesn't, for example, have something like kamikaze UAVs, but that's at least one case in which that advantage is sort of caught up with. Not fully, of course, they're much less sophisticated. So I think that your worry about dictator, for instance, with a robot army is a good one. On the other hand, it'll depend really on cost. I mean, look at al-Assad's Air Force. Not only is it in shambles, it's very old, and the planes are much cheaper, you know, than anything like a much larger state would have, or wealthier state would have.
Just to add to your point regarding, it's pretty difficult to determine in advance which technology will win. I think that with a high rate of cyber attack going on, you know, what would happen is that the state actors would covertly be able to steal technology from the other. And maybe what would eventually be the winning trick would be strategies, which strategies would still play a very critical role in determining which, you know, actor is able to deploy resources efficiently and effectively, you know, over the course of the future. So I think their just main technology firepower would not necessarily determine who wins, you know, particular warfare.
Looking at what happened in Syria, for example, we might think of if people get more power as individuals, they might rise against the state and state would get lower power. But I guess the Syria situation showed that once that happens, it's the borders that are threatened, and then the foreign countries would immediately interfere and try to take advantage. So in case of a conflict between the state and the civil individuals, what happens is that history has always shown that the fight is not going to be focused only between the people until one of them wins or something happens. Immediately, foreign powers would interfere and situation gets really complicated and becomes entangled, as we can see in Syria.
I partly agree. So I think what you were saying earlier, Michael, about this military theory, when you talk about one versus an enemy, I think that's something, and now related to Haas, that's something that might have been at some point in theory accurate, but I think today in like a much more complex world where like everybody is kind of partnered, like every country has partners in other countries and other countries would interfere in such a case, I think that makes all this theory much harder. And I think, so this brings me now to like the democratization, decentralization that you, Boaz, were saying earlier. I think that's also, again, you can view that in light of like the larger phenomena that comes through the internet, where like basically everybody can connect to everybody, everybody can form groups, great or like impactful things in the real world can happen out of this. But of course, with like military technologies, for example, or like with all kinds of aggressions or conflicts, this can have much more dangerous implications in this context. And then also, again, what I was saying earlier, the kind of stable constellation with countries, you know, like countries watching other countries and all countries having kind of military technologies, making everything kind of stable. This again becomes more unstable in this view of democratization. So I think that's an issue. That's how I understand it.
I also think that decentralization of like technology is not the way that we are perceiving it's going to be. Even the reason is because like right now, essentially everybody can create guns, but kind of the technology is like limited to a few people, like the mass productions of guns by Russia and then US and other countries. And I kind of perceive it in the same way. Like for example, 3D printing guns, you still need to have 3D printer, and having a 3D printer is much sophisticated technology and is not something accessible for lots of people. So it's not that everybody can have their own guns. I guess it's even become like it's not going to be something as distributed as we think. It's same with other technology also, I guess, is actually requires much more sophisticated technology, and those sophisticated technology is not necessarily distributed for lots of people. And that's the way I perceive it. And I guess like lots of countries, as we see in Syria and other things, they think about more creative way, but not with less technology, like suicide bombing or something else. That's my
It's going to affect the tactics for sure. And different tactics are certainly emerging. But I just want to say, in response to the last comment, you say that the democratization, as we've called it, or the diffusion, say, of people's ability to use force is increased by technology. And there was a suggestion that it would lead to more instability. I think that's perfectly correct. So I agree 100% with that. And I hope I didn't sound too optimistic. In reality, I'm very pessimistic about this.
Right. And it does seem like the idea of the Arab Spring and other kinds of people power movements have been, the idea there was that people would be able to stand up to the state and they would be able to express their political will through these new technologies, through information technologies, etc. But it does seem like it's been met with disappointment. And instead, it's been co-opted by the most extreme elements and possibly even foreign state actors, and hasn't led to the optimistic outcomes that maybe it sounded like we were thinking might happen. Instead, it looks like we're all agreeing that that's probably not actually the reality.
Yeah, I think a distinction is in order here, by the way. We should be talking or be careful to distinguish insurgency versus conventional, whatever you want to call it, head-to-head warfare between larger powers of the sort you see in the Gulf War, for instance. And so I think when we're talking about this, we should be clear, maybe on, I'm saying myself included, we should be clear on whether we're talking about insurgencies becoming more powerful or whether we're talking about insurgent groups being able to meet governments head-to-head in sort of semi-insurgent, semi-conventional ways. Because certainly insurgencies are always, as was just suggested with, for instance, suicide bombings, insurgencies are always going to find novel tactics to make up for some of these asymmetries.
Right. So let me take the conversation in a slightly different direction, inspired by what you're saying there, Boaz, because the history, as I alluded to at the very beginning of our conversation, the history of military strategy is dictated by the balance of power between defensive and offensive technologies. So in World War I, we had very, very powerful defensive technology available for the first time. We had machine guns. So one soldier at the top of a hill could defend that hill against 100, maybe I'm exaggerating slightly, but against many other soldiers. Right, and no exaggeration. There you go. So you ended up with trench warfare. It was a stalemate because the defensive power was so much higher than the offensive power. But then quickly, tanks were developed, more powerful artillery was developed. So in the interwar years, technology changed, and you ended up in World War II with probably maybe what we would say is a relatively balanced situation where both offensive and defensive military technologies were balanced somewhat, and then you had a real fight. And so after World War II, we had, again, a switch back to defensive technology in the form of counterforce nuclear capability, making it impossible to have a conflict between the two major powers in the world. And now we're seeing a lot of asymmetric warfare because of what I perceive as too much power on the offensive side. So even if you have billions and billions of dollars like the American military has, you still can't defend against, you know, Osama bin Laden's team running up a dinghy against your boat and blowing itself up. And then now we're seeing with UAVs and drones, a similar situation where any Yahoo can fly this thing over the White House and potentially cause a problem. So I'm wondering what we think about offensive versus defensive. Do we think that in the future, the defensive technologies will catch up, or How will the balance of power between defensive and offensive technologies play out in the next few years?
I'm going to insist right out of the starting gate here, Michael, on another distinction. And then maybe you'll have something to say about this. Sorry to be like the parody of the philosopher. Everything's a distinction. But I think when we're talking about this, we got to make clear whether we're talking about tactical offensive or strategic offensive, and likewise defensive. Because defending a ship, for instance, against attack is tactical. It's very important, but it's a different kind of defense than defending a country's borders. On the other hand, as the Nazis very well, not as quickly as maybe they should have learned, there's a very big difference between tactical bombing in a theater, you know, or in the field, like we need to take out that bridge to stop them from coming here, and then strategic bombing of the sort that the Americans were much more capable of doing, where you go deep into enemy territory and on the offensive, you bomb their factories. So those are, I would say they're two defensive and two offensive at least. If you're a Soviet theorist, you'll say there's three, but we'll leave that out.
Wow. Okay. We'll try to take that into account. That's a great point. So any thoughts, guys? Any predictions? Defensive versus offensive?
As offensive strategies can always be a good way of also defensive. It's like you see a lot of countries that by being offensive, I guess you're one step ahead before you start to get defensive. So it's one way. It's kind of like coming from a stronger standpoint when you're in the offensive situation. But at the same time, you might expose some weak points when you're in the offensive situation. So it's kind of hard to predict. I guess both are going to work together, and depending on the political atmosphere, things would always change. I don't think there's such a thing to predict that the world would turn into a more defensive situation or offensive.
I think I agree with the last point, but I also think that, largely speaking, we will continue to see a rise in advancement in military technology because government, you know, you are not sure of the capability of your enemy, and you want to continue to build up momentum just in case there's a future warfare. But however, I think that going into the future, governments will also be very hesitant to deploy military, you know, tactics to resolve global issues in the future because you are not sure what scale the warfare could become, and it could be difficult to stop.
In my feeling, it would probably be more investments made into offense, just because I think that, for example, that if I use the terms you just introduced, Boss, correctly, that a tactical offense also serves as a strategic defense.
Yeah.
Particularly in such a like deeply connected world. Connected, I mean now, not through information technology, but more through partnerships. So I guess, yeah, that would definitely reduce the probability for somebody to attack in the first place. So I think that's kind of the defense on the one side because of the potential later counterattack from whatever party. Or what do you think?
Yeah, okay, so I think, let me paint in broad strokes and you can tell me if this makes sense. Because Michael, you want us to speculate on the future, so I'm not going to say this is exactly my studied view, but here goes. So I think that we're going to see a lot more tactical offense and strategic defense, especially on the part of state actors who want to, so to speak, join the nuclear club. I know that American media has been, I think, quite hysterical in its talk about, you know, the capacity of the North Korean dictatorship to strike, say, California, but as far as I've been able to see, and in all the literature I've read on this, it seems as though this is not being pursued as an offensive capacity, but as a defensive one to prevent the Americans from meddling in North Korean affairs, or other foreign powers from meddling in North Korean affairs, and to somewhat, I think, diminish the role of the United States by rattling U.S. allies in the region, you know, flying missiles over Japanese airspace and so forth. So that seems to me to be a bit actually more on the defensive side. Meanwhile, we're seeing a lot more on the offensive side, what I would call tactically. Although, to what extent terrorism is directed at tactical rather than strategic aims is something I'm not fully sure I've made my mind up on. Certainly, it has strategic aims and has attained those strategic aims very often. But I think what we'll end up seeing then is perhaps state actors that aren't able to confront each other directly precisely because of the defensive deterrent who will resort to non-conventional means. This is one possibility. I'm putting this out as a possibility, not as like my prediction.
Anyone else with a prediction? I think Parni.
That wasn't a prediction, but I just said. Okay, I see what you're saying.
Yeah, fair enough. Can't pin anyone down here. Yeah. Okay, I have a prediction on what Michael O said there, because Michael O, you were pointing out that states may become even more hesitant to deploy military tactics, the kind of tactics that they might have deployed in, say, World War II involving thousands of soldiers dying are just not possible today. Like, even contemplating Churchill's Gallipoli campaign in World War One, where thousands upon thousands upon thousands of Anzac and other country soldiers dying just to get a foothold on a strategic peninsula there. There's no way that would take place today. And I think in the future, even individual soldiers, you know, their biographies, you know, blazoned on cable news, I think it'll be very difficult for human lives to be put at risk in these asymmetric situations, which is going to empower the non-state actors unless we develop really capable robotic soldiers. Because I think once we have really capable robotic soldiers, I think then the power will swing back to the defensive again, and basically combined with miniature drones that can perhaps tag or take out individual terrorists, I think that it's quite possible that, for example, let's talk about the Sri Lanka conflict just very briefly. The Tamil Tigers were a group that were fighting for independence in Sri Lanka for decades, and there were some number of thousands of Tamil Tigers. Now imagine if the Sri Lankan government had access to miniature drones that could fly into the terrorist houses and figure out who was who using facial recognition, and then just infect them all with a virus that's timed to, you know, act at the same moment, right? And then, you know, this state actor with this capability would be able to completely destroy every Tamil Tiger at the same moment in time. I feel like that technology, again, combined with robot soldiers, will mean that defensive capabilities will be the most powerful in the future. That's my prediction.
Are you also predicting that Sri Lanka will not be a part of the Geneva Convention then as well?
Well, this is all black ops stuff, of course. I don't think the CIA would be hesitant to do this, especially if they're all terrorists, right? You don't think the CIA would do this with Al-Qaeda?
I don't know. But the reason I said that is not just to give you a hard time. I'm saying, to what extent will laws change to accommodate these things as well? I don't have an answer to that question, but it's worth considering.
Yeah, great point. Any other predictions, guys, or should we move on to the next question? All right. One question I have for you is, if we think that any particular military technology will become obsolete. So right now we have infantry, we have the Navy, we have submarines, we have ballistic missiles, we have an Air Force with piloted planes. Are any of these technologies, which, by the way, most of the world's militaries are still spending billions of dollars on and acquiring a hardware that's intended to last for 20, 30, 40, 50 years, are any of these technologies going to become obsolete in the next few years? Anyone care to venture a prediction?
Well, the easy one to go with, of course, is piloted aircraft. And I would add piloted ships probably to that. We'll see, not to say that there won't be people on these ships, but I think we'll see less and less of that. I wonder whether the technology that's being put into unmanned ships and the technology that's being put into unmanned planes, they're still working on this, but, you know, they've been taking off these UAVs that can land themselves on carriers completely automatically. If you follow that progression through, then you'll see perhaps a fully automated, mostly automated aircraft carrier. Of course, the aircraft carrier, I'm picking this because I don't think it's going anywhere. It's vital to American power projection, so that's something that's not going to disappear in form, but might start looking very different.
Can I challenge you on that particular piece of power projection?
Can you? Please.
Well, with railguns, with stealth submarines, is it possible that any surface ships will become obsolete because it'll just be too easy to take them out?
Well, I think what we've seen since, you know, like more recently is that a great deal of the rest of the Navy is in a kind of supporting role to these carrier strike groups, right? So let me just tease this out. Is your question, will they become obsolete because they'll be easy to strike? Or is your question, will they become obsolete because power projection will take a different form?
The former. I think it's likely that these giant sitting ducks out there, even if they have a chain of battleships surrounding them, these aircraft carriers will just be too easy to take out because of advances in submarine torpedo technology and, I guess, more asymmetric sorts of small aircraft that could come in. You disagree?
I disagree, especially just given how much work seems to be going into these, like, anti-access area denial, the A2AD, layered defenses, where there's so much, if you can picture it as kind of a bubble that surrounds these ships or surrounds, like, say, a coastal installation that uses precisely this information technology that we've been discussing to be able to counter those threats, to be able to predict them in advance and so forth. So I'm not entirely sure, especially if we're talking about aggression, tactical aggression from non-state actors, also whether who's going to give them railguns. But you never know. I mean, history is always interesting. I'm of the opinion that the tail wags the dog on these things, but it's also because I've been reading more about World War I lately, so it's not been helping my pessimism.
Yeah.
Does that answer your question, Michael?
Yeah, well, that's one man's opinion. I have an opinion. Anyone else care to venture an opinion about any technologies that will become obsolete?
Yeah, I guess one thing I can think of, the technologies that would empower individual people to get involved in on-foot fight would get less and less invested on, because first is there's not much proof of future in advancing in brain control, mind control, and so on. So human psychology is still by far one of the weakest points of the militaries and the traumas that soldiers go through. It's very expensive actually to train individual humans in comparing with investing that money and come up with robotic machines and like tanks and so on and drones. So I guess the more we get into future, the more things, as you mentioned correctly, things are getting unmanned. So I guess that would be a point that the militaries would start evolving from towards a different direction.
Can I say one thing, because I'll be kicking myself if I don't add this, because I recently read this very interesting book called Air Power. I think it's subtitled like The Men and Machines That Revolutionized War. Very, very interesting book. And one of the points, I believe it was here that he makes it, he says that very often the Air Force is actually, he calls it the least intellectual of the service branches, because their way of dealing with a new problem is to invent a new gadget, right, rather than to come up with a new tactic the way that, for instance, cavalry had to do, the Navy has had to do, the Army has had to do. So instead, they just invent something new. So here's a prediction. If democratization of these technologies continues, if we see more and more non-state actors using UAVs more and more effectively and so forth, then the one piece of military technology, to use that term very loosely, that will always, always be needed is the military academies where people study strategy.
Great point. All right. I want to take the last 5 minutes for an additional topic that I think I would kick myself if we didn't talk about, which is a topic that I will introduce by quoting Vladimir Putin, the brilliant military strategist, Vladimir Putin. He recently was quoted as saying, "Whoever reaches a breakthrough in developing artificial intelligence will come to dominate the world." So Putin, he was speaking with students in June, and he said that the development of AI raises colossal opportunities and threats that are difficult to predict now, but the one who becomes leader in this sphere will be the ruler of the world. And he warned that it would be strongly undesirable, he says, if someone wins a monopolist position, and promised that Russia would be ready to share its know-how in artificial intelligence with other nations.
Interesting.
And so I wonder what we think about this, because there's been other articles recently talking about how China has a major position now with its scientists in machine learning and artificial intelligence, one of the artificial intelligence technologies being machine learning, that it's distinctly possible that China will be a first mover in developing artificial general intelligence. And so I wonder what we think about this, how we think artificial intelligence will affect military conflicts, and do we think that one state has an advantage over some others?
I just have to immediately comment that Putin saying that we would share is clearly stating that how from a weak point he's talking about. Because if any state would get the higher arm on AI, they would never want to share. He wouldn't either, because he's one of the most authoritative leaders in the world, and I would never imagine he would share with anybody. But him saying that means that he's asking the stronger states to share with him. So, and clearly that China is the leading state in that. So I should have said that before we move forward.
That's a great point. Seeing through is BS. Got it. Anyone else with a thought on this?
I have a very hard time interpreting anything that Putin does on the grounds that it's not clear whether the things that he supposedly says to foreign states are meant to be seen by those foreign states, or whether it's primarily things he wants his own people to see him saying to those foreign states. So I don't know how to interpret Putin's comment. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. What if we take the speaker out of the picture and we just say,
okay,
well, it's quite possible that AI will be a decisive factor in future conflict. But I'm trying to understand exactly how. Is it that military strategy really is that important? And we're going to get like a AI version of Napoleon that will be able to implement precisely the right tactics? Or is it something else?
Well, Lord willing, artificial intelligence will at least have a longer standing effect than Napoleon. I would hazard to guess, I would go as far as to say that strategy is so vital that I'm not sure whether it'll be left up to machines for a very long time. Maybe one day it will, but I wonder whether you're talking about AI's, not to keep bringing this distinction up, but AI's application in a tactical sense or in a strategic sense.
I think both, and I guess in the former it will be, as you said, I agree with you there that in the former it will be much more effective, yeah.
So does anyone have any thoughts about how this AI power will manifest itself? Go ahead, Haas.
Exactly. That was the point I was trying to say, that artificial intelligence, as its name clearly shows, it's an intelligence. So I guess it would be a vital tool in the hands of the strategists. I don't think artificial intelligence would ever, in the far future, would be a last decision-making system. And it would create a lot of data, it would generate a lot of data, and would make it much easier for the final decision-maker to make that decision. Mm-hmm. Because if you think about it, AI would be the decision-maker, then the war is between who and who then? Is it between an AI and another country? Like, so the wars we're talking about here, the militaries we're talking about here, is the fights and wars between humans. So if you want to go beyond that, if an AI becomes independent and makes its own decisions, then who is it serving then? It's serving itself. So that would be situation.
I think also that there's at least one way, Michael, to answer your question. One way you can answer this question is to say that, like UAVs and especially autonomous UAVs, we can risk a great deal more because we're really just risking hardware. We're not risking a soldier's life, a potential diplomatic crisis, and so forth, right? So I think that if that's the case, you know, a downed UAV is not as much of an embarrassment as, say, a pilot who now we have to negotiate to get back and who's appearing on TV making all kinds of embarrassing pronouncements about our country and so forth, and whose parents are now being interviewed by the media and so forth. That's a huge disaster, whereas a downed UAV is a lost, it's a lost model plane, so to speak, right? Not to downplay the price. So if that allows us to become more tactically risk tolerant, which I think it does, then that's going to also affect our strategy as well, right? Because it's going to mean we don't have to pick our battles in the same way that we normally would have. I think that's an attempt to answer your question.
Great. Michael O?
Yes, I think that going to the future, AI will play a very important role in military, you know, technology. And if we start seeing a lot of machine power that is also able to collect data. So imagine that, you know, you deploy maybe an unmanned machine gun and it's also able to collect data on the environment and maybe it's allowed to make some decisions. So you have a very adaptive machine gun or some form of machinery that is able to adapt to its environment. You know, I think that will probably be the next level when it comes to, you know, using AI and artificial data, you know, surrounding data to make decisions. So if we keep seeing these advancements going on, then you'll probably see a lot more unmanned operations, especially in very difficult terrain, like, you know, going to Al-Qaeda to dislodge the operations in that space in general.
Yeah, what you're referring to, Michael O, is, I guess, tactical AI, where in individual conflicts and engagements, the AI is able to make decisions more and more autonomously without seeking approval from its human leaders. Whereas in my original conception, I was thinking about AI as the military planner sitting in the military high office deciding on where to deploy troops. But I suppose AI could be used in either context and remains to be seen where it would be most usefully deployed. Daniel, go ahead.
One trend of, let's call it dumb military technology, is to have a massive destruction radius or like basically just being very, very invasive. And I guess AI would be something that would narrow that down again. AI would be a technology that could make weapons much more narrowed and much more precise. So basically, if you want to make sure that one person gets killed in a specific building of many people, you can basically ensure that by also integrating with existing AIs. And also regarding the strategists will be really empowered using like different AI technologies, maybe much more tactical AI, military technologies. But I guess I like slightly agree with Putin. Maybe also AIs or like big data technologies often tend to construct monopolies, at least for some time, because they often include a lot of like computational power and everything and data. And so that might be actually a very unstable position that we or situation that we will come to at some point.
Mm-hmm. Can I add just one final thing, Michael, about the strategic use of AI in making sort of big decisions, is that I think very often the decisions and the sort of reasoning that goes into them is so controversial. And there's so much disagreement about whether or not this or that, say, human in general, you know, Caesar or Douglas MacArthur or somebody made the right decision in this case or that case. The considerable prejudice that we have in favor of humans, I think, is going to tip it in favor of human strategic decision makers for a very long time, simply because unless you foresee an AI that's able to debate, make its points, you know, sort of persuasively, rather than just churning out a strategy. And even in that case, I think there's going to be considerable skepticism about that. And I'm willing to say that maybe just a prejudice.
I 100% agree with that. There's always a black box involved with AI. And I always think it's very funny. For example, if I remember the game where the last year where the Go player was beaten, when you watch the game, actually, there was one scene where the AI would make a move and then the world class best Go player would just stand up and leave the room for 15 minutes all counting to his time, just because the move was so unpredictable, and also the Google engineers could not explain why they did it. They were assuming that it had something to do with the AI being programmed to maximize the probability to win as opposed to the probability or like the difference in score to win. And so, yeah, so that's a really fun example. I think how big of a black box there is very often involved in AI that the engineers themselves can't explain. And maybe so I said my, maybe I didn't explain well enough. I didn't mean that the strategy will be made by an AI, but I think a strategist, a human strategist, will be extremely empowered by using AI.
Oh, yeah.
Or different AIs in terms of military technologies, in terms of other AIs, and in terms of both combined. And I think there's a lot of like synergetic effects that will like crazily empower strategists.
Yeah. Yeah, I would add to that, especially because if you look at the way that...
Sorry, go ahead, Boaz. And then Haas, you go ahead after Boaz.
So just the debates, like it's one of the fascinating... John Keegan has a really good book on World War II, and I've been thinking more about what makes it such a good book. And I think it's partly that it spends so much time on the debates among generals and among statesmen about what to do in this situation. And very often it comes down to some one person's gut intuition or something. And so that's going to be a very difficult thing to incorporate AI into. On the other hand, if it plays a supporting role, at very least, it would allow a kind of weighting and taking into consideration of many more data than otherwise would have been possible. If I'm understanding you correctly, is that what you're saying?
That is exactly what I'm saying. More AI as a tool to make more or better informed decisions.
Yeah, that's a great. And AI also, it doesn't become an alcoholic, which is more than we can say for a lot of the commanders in World War II.
Oh, is that true? Yeah.
That's supposed to have been true.
Oh, well. Yeah, that's what I hear people say. When you want to invest and diversify your portfolio, but you don't want to spend in military technologies, a lot of people always say, yeah, just spend in alcohol. It has similar correlations there.
I don't want that to sound like a prejudiced remark. I understand that alcoholism is a crippling, you know, all I'm saying is that it seems to have been responsible for a number of rash and maybe later actually successful, but largely based on gut intuition decisions, and AI won't be making that, which gives it actually an alarming degree, perhaps, of predictability.
Well,
contrary. But I don't want to sound like I'm picking on alcoholism, by the way. I'm sorry if that...
Well,
maybe the black box coming from an AI is also like alcoholism and makes it more unpredictable. And also, yeah, it's then kind of like it's not even clear if it's on the pro or on the con side if AI can't become an alcoholist.
Right. Well, Churchill may have been drunk, but Hitler was on crystal meth, apparently. So, you know, there's there's drugs and there's drugs. Haas, I believe you had a final comment.
Sure. Speaking of AI, I had to mention this example in favor of defending human intelligence and how, even though we are trying to incorporate AI to move from more subjective decision making to objective decision making, but there are faults that we should not oversee. And one of the examples in criminology nowadays, one of the very favorable tools that people are trying to achieve is having algorithms, artificial and intelligent algorithms that can predict what is the percentage, what is the probability that a prisoner that leaves the prison would commit crime again. So in that sense, it would give a lot of information to the hands of the judge, so they would have better sense to judge how many years they should take or when is the best time for them to leave the prison and so on. And one of the examples is that there are some statistics that show African American people are actually taken by the police 5 times more for speaking marijuana. So there is, from one point of view, some statistics correctly show that African Americans are being imprisoned 5 times more. And then if you just feed that data to your AI, to your algorithm, that would predict. So if an African American person leaves the prison, so the judge, based on that data, there's no way that he can just not make a decision against the African American or the white person. But the truth is, another factor that is playing a role here is that the policing in the neighborhoods that African Americans live is always as much, almost 5 times more than in white neighborhoods. So actually, there are statistics in terms of consumption of and the sales of the marijuana shows that actually whites and African Americans consume equal amounts of marijuana. But the policing difference is playing a role here. So here's an example, like, because the data we are feeding to our artificial intelligence algorithms are always fed by humans and are fed by data that is being affected by some factors like racism and so on, some prejudice, human prejudice is always going to play a role. So there's always a danger of us trusting them too much without questioning the data that we're feeding.
Great point about trusting AI. Yeah, good point, Haas. Parni, do you have a final thought?
I really like Haas' last comment. It's actually true that African American, yeah, that like one in third of African American men, they go to jail based on the biases that exist in the justice system. And there was actually one talk I was at Stanford, which exactly elaborate the same issue that with current, like, for example, AI system, that we're taking into consideration what we can do in what's the like promises of, like, for example, or even the machine learning like algorithm that we are right now have, like the neural net is like much better at predicting faces of like white black people because that's the data that they feed in. And also, like, for example, for criminal like justice is like, because the current like data system is like completely unbiased, like it's completely biased. So that data could really increase the output or the prediction that we are looking for. So I'm not too sure like what would be the solution for that, but I believe that there's lots of problems that we need to consider seriously, especially with the current technology that we are embedded in our day-to-day life.
Now that the example has been said twice, can I quickly comment on that? I think I agree that there's, for example, maybe even racism, like influencing AI. But I think this specific example is slightly flawed because if you're talking about people that go back to jail after leaving, I think when you're talking about African Americans, they already have a much larger sample rate of people who are in prison, which mitigates that issue again. So basically we will have, for example, if the arrests will become more equally distributed, meaning maybe like less racist, let's call it that way, society, by the delay of the time in that process of people like already being in jail, it will actually become an AI that will maybe even become racist towards white people because there will be so many, or like white people, like maybe non-African Americans, because there's so many African Americans in jail, and meaning that there's much less of these, of like, let's say marijuana arrested people that will go back to jail, meaning that there's actually a shift in numbers that will have the contrary effect, just to that specific example. But generally, I totally agree with what you said, and also with the potentially dangerous or surprising implication that might have for AI and military technology as well.
Yeah, that's a great point. Anyone else with a final comment? Okay, well
should we? Can we meet back, Michael, in 10 years? Can we have a reunion and see who is, you know, how our predictions worked out? Or
good point.
That's right. If we haven't been crushed by Terminator robots by then, I agree. Let's meet on September 17th, 2027, and decide who was right and who was wrong. And I look forward, maybe we'll have an AI participant at that point.
I'll send you the calendar invitation.
Excellent. I think we can probably make the booking. That's right, in Google Calendar. Why not?
Yeah, and we should also automate a Facebook post that in case we don't meet, it automatically triggers a Facebook post where it says we were right.
Yes, perhaps, Michael, if the Terminator robots take over, they'll at least keep us alive until we've completed our appointment. So it might be worthwhile to let them know that we're planning to do this.
Well, that would be very courteous of those robots, yes.
They will assume that we're the most they will assume that we're the most intellectual beings here because we actually predicted it. So they will let us have that meeting.
I hope so. Okay.
Well, thank you so much for this, Michael. This has been really great. Always a pleasure.
Yes. Thank you, Boaz, for making time this morning to talk to us and lending your expertise and your thoughts.
Yeah. Thank you, Boaz, for joining our conversation today. We wish we would have you in following meetings. And I thank everybody for their great participation. I had a great time talking to you today. Thank you.
Thank you. I had a lot of fun. Realized how little I think actually about military technology and that it's like a way too complex topic. And I think I'm not sure how much more I will think about it now that we talked about this. I wish you all a great day, assuming that I'm in the most eastern time zone right now because Michael is in Canada. So everybody, good morning, good day.
Thank you, everyone. I really enjoyed the conversation. As always, we're talking about the future and implications of technology, and it's great to see you all.
All right, guys. Have a good day.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Let's make the future. Visit us online at letsmakethefuture.com.